called Power BI, which is basically a business intelligence and data analysis tool based on the cloud. But what I'm going to talk about is how do you connect and work with business data when the business data is on-premise. Now, when I talk about on-premise, I don't mean that your data is on a server sitting locally in your office. When I say on-premise, it means that some kind of business data which is maybe hosted in the cloud, but in either a private cloud or in a data center, maybe on actually physically on-premise, which is different from the cloud service itself, which is Power BI. So how do you actually organize your data and how do you actually get that data into the cloud is what I'm going to talk about in today's session. Just a quick introduction about myself. My name is Vinod Unny. I'm a senior technology consultant in a company called Enterprise Infotech. I also happen to be have a title called Microsoft Regional Director. This is an honorary title. I am not employed by Microsoft, which means I don't unfortunately get a salary from Microsoft, which is very sad. Right, so it's a title that Microsoft gives to people in the field whom they consider as experts. So we are about 120 in the world. So we work very closely with the Microsoft teams back in Redmond and give them feedback. And believe me, we are very, very critical of Microsoft directly on their face. Right? So when they make a mistake, we are the ones who go and tell them that, boss, you've really screwed up. Right? So that's a quick introduction about myself and some other stuff on the slide, but I'm going to skip through that. So a quick agenda of what I'm going to talk about. First, I'm not sure that it's very clear, but don't worry about that. So I'll give you an overview of what BI actually is and what are the different solutions that are there and how do you actually work with business intelligence. And then we'll take a look at Power BI and how it actually helps you solve this in the cloud and get that data from your business data, your business processes, your DevOps processes and push them into the cloud to do analysis on them and what's the advantage of doing all of that. So that's what I'm going to talk about, and I will try and show you a few live demos if time permits and if the internet gods are on our side. I'll try and show a few demos live as well, and live demos are always dangerous. They sometimes don't work, right? So but I will attempt it. I have taken a video of it working, so in case it doesn't work, I'll show you the video of it working. Right, so a quick run through of what is BI. How many of you work with BI? None of you, right? So BI, if you look at business intelligence and you read the books and you read about it, there's a very complex definition of BI. I mean, you can see by, and that's just one sentence that I've taken out of the official definition of business intelligence. It's called a broad category of application programs and technologies for gathering, storing, blah, 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 big long stuff, right? It doesn't make sense. To put it a little bit more simply, let's put it a little bit more in normal English, it is the application of knowledge derived from analyzing an organization's data to effect a more positive outcome. But it's actually a little simpler. Basically, knowledge by analyzing data to get some good positive result. To put it even more simply, it is basically picking up data, raw data, converting it to information, and then from that information, getting some knowledge out of it. Right? That's what business intelligence is all about. So forget all the stuff that you will read about. If you ever get into BI, you will read all this stuff. But the essence, and BI is an old technology, it's been around for 30, 40 years. The tools are new, the way that you evolve and use it is new, but the concepts behind it is not very, it's been around for a long time. But in the end, the essence is basically data to information to knowledge. That's what you need to understand what business intelligence is. Obviously, with the tools that are there and available today in the cloud and stuff like that, there are a whole lot of new ways that you can get all of this information. So what is BI used for? It's used for understanding the health of the organization. This could mean anything. This could mean how are sales doing, right? How are sales doing in a particular region? How are your servers' health doing, right? It could be any kind of data. It does not matter what that data is. The BI is used to actually analyze, understand, and then even predict, in some cases, what is going to happen. Collaborate on a shared view of business drivers. Now, one of the problems that happens when you have a large organization is that you might not have the same view of business drivers. For example, if a if a sales region in India sells items in rupees and a sales region in the US sells it in dollars, a $10 sale is not equivalent to a 10 rupee sale. You need to have a common view. That means you need to convert it into a common set, a common unit, a common thing. So you need to collaborate and view that shared data driver. And then of course reduce the time to decision. You need to have information extremely fast, and I'll show you that how that happens if the demo works fine, right? And obviously the goal is to impact the bottom line. That means it doesn't matter whether you're a startup which has just shipped its first item today, right? It doesn't matter. Or you are a 30-year-old company, multinational with tens of thousands of employees. As long as you are able to analyze that data and reach a decision quickly, you might be selling, you know, you might be, your product might be an app, and how is that app doing? Or your product might be t-shirts and shoes, and how is that selling? Or your product might be services, and how are your servers doing? Now, I don't mean real-time server, real-time information of whether a server is down or up. That you get from AWS and Azure and all of them, you will get that. But how have they been performing over time? How, you know, what are the issues that have come up? What issues affect what, right? The different types of insights that can come up are quite important to understand, right? So now, how do you do all of this? What are the BI solutions that are available there? So the problem in today's world is that organizations have data stored in many different areas, right? There are silos of data. Data could be on server logs. Data could be in databases, data could be in CRMs, ERP systems, lots of different things that are available. And they may not be optimized for analytical queries. Now, what does that mean? How do you analyze this data? If you look at a server log, I mean, if you look at raw server logs, you can really never understand what is there. If you look at raw data in a database of sales, transactional data, you can never understand what is actually going on, what is actually happening. You're looking at individual information at one time. How do you manage historical context? What has things been in the past? How is it happening now? What is the trend? Right? So that is not available as you look at data as you go along. The other problem is that most employees don't have the skills to look at to analyze data. Right? Most people don't know how to do it. In fact, BI is a very technical, it's a very technical concept. It's a very, you need to have understanding of data models and a lot of other things. So that is not something that a business manager or a decision maker will actually have to understand. So that's where BI actually comes in. So if you look at data silos, there could be multiple data silos, HR, finance, CRM, and these are all silos of your organization. If you look at silos that are coming in from outside your organization, like there could be your vendor's data. How do you correlate your data with the vendor's data? Or how do you correlate your data with external data? For example, external data could be things like weather information. Is your sale actually impacted if the weather is bad? How do you figure that out? Right? So that is where this sort of stuff comes in, where you can actually go into business intelligence processing and then come out with analytics and visualizations which tell you this information. There are a lot of insights that can come in, right? Now, business intelligence, there are tons of solutions that are out there. I'm going to talk about one which is called Power BI, which is basically a suite of business analytical tools from Microsoft. Now, just because it comes from Microsoft does not mean that it will only work with, say, SQL Server, right? It is completely platform agnostic. Right? It does not matter. Your data could be anything. MySQL, Mongo, Cosmos, whatever. It doesn't matter. Whether it's stored on Azure, whether stored locally on your laptop, it doesn't matter. Right? It could actually be physically on your laptop, not even on a server for all that matters, and you're sitting inside your office and you could still get that data analyzed. Right? Power BI itself is available. So it's a cloud-based service. It's available both standalone, and you can get it as part of Office 365. So it depends how you want to get it. It connects, as I said, to hundreds of different types of data sources, and they are adding more data sources on a day-to-day basis almost. The data prep, which is the more complicated part, which usually requires a consultant to do it, or you need somebody with business intelligence knowledge to be able to do that, that is done via a very simple user experience. I will show that to you in a moment. Very, very simple to do. If you have worked with Excel, you basically know how to use it. Right, more or less. And you can do extremely detailed queries via these prepared things or completely ad hoc. If you don't know how to do it, you can do a very ad hoc query and still get data analysis done on that. The service, the cloud-based service, is actually, because it is backed by Microsoft Cloud, it has AI and NLP built in, which means that a non-technical user, like a manager, can actually go and type in a query like, tell me the sales, give me an analysis of sales of France over the last 3 years, right? And you will get a proper visualization from the Power BI service, which will actually show that information very clearly out, saying that, okay, this is the entire sale history of France, or whatever region that is there. So very, very customizable, and very nice, interactive, and fluid visualizations that are there. Now, how is Power BI available? There are two versions. There is a desktop version, and there is a service. The service is obviously the more powerful thing. The desktop is actually just for creating the user experience. And service itself is available in three different subscriptions called Personal, Pro, and Premium. I'm just going to quickly run through this. The desktop is obviously on the desktop. It's free. You can just simply go and download it from powerbi.com. It's also available on the Windows Store. Just simply go download, install, and you can start using it. Power BI Personal is again free. It's a cloud-based service. It's absolutely free. You can actually go and start using it. The only restriction here in Power BI Personal is that any analysis that you do cannot be shared with others in your organization. That's the only restriction. Otherwise, everything else is there. Power BI Pro, which is the full edition of Power BI, again, available standalone or available as part of Office 365, so the difference between the Personal and Pro, both are cloud-based, but Pro allows you to share any analysis that you've done within your organization, just with a couple of clicks. And this costs about 600 rupees per user per month, which is actually very, very cheap. So even a startup can afford this, right? You need one Power BI Pro license and 600 rupees per month. That's what you need. Power BI Premium is obviously the premium experience. This is expensive. It is capacity planned, cloud-based service, and available via a license partner only. This starts from 6 lakh rupees per month, right? So that's the first level. So this is equivalent to, if you've heard of other platforms like Tableau, this is where so Tableau is the direct competitor to Power BI Premium because they start at around the same price. And that is, of course, your break-even is around when you have 500 users of Power BI. That's when your break-even starts off. Right, so if you are higher than that, then of course Power BI Premium is a very good thing, but before that it's kind of painful. So how do you analyze data? Very, very simple. You basically connect or point your Power BI service to your data source. Right? The data source, as I said, can be anywhere. It could be in the cloud, it could be inside an on-premise network, it could be in your data center, it could be on your laptop for all it matters. Right? It doesn't matter, it will connect to that. You create a data model based on the data source, the data that you're trying to analyze. You create certain reports, right? You apply some visualizations and there are some things, and I'll try and show this to you. You highlight, so if you have a report with some 20 different insights that you're working with, and you want to highlight some of them, you can highlight them into a dashboard, which maybe managers or somebody can quickly take a look at those dashboards to see what's happening. And then, of course, share the report or the dashboard or the content itself to others in your organization. So I'm just going to try and show you a quick demo of this. So what I have here, and I'm just going to quickly go to the cloud-based service. So I'm logging in. So this is already connected to my, I'm connected to the Power BI service. Now this is one report that I have actually created. It's not probably going to be very clear because of the resolution that is showing up, but this is some sample sales data that is there. The colors actually are much more vibrant, but it's not showing up here. So this is basically sales over time, right? So this is sales over time and by the region. This one is sales over the category, so there are different categories. This is sales over currency. This is sales over region, so you can see North America, within that you have United States and Canada, you have Europe, you have United Kingdom, Germany and France, and this is again sales over time. Right? Now, this looks like a simple enough report which you can quickly create in Excel, but the power that comes up is that one, it is shareable. The second is that it's cross-highlightable. For example, if I click on United States dollar here, what happens is that, I don't know whether you noticed, but the values on the graphs actually change based on what your selection is. So you can see that these are what got highlighted. Right? So Canada has fallen, Canada was full, but it's, the highlighted part is only this much. Right? And these graphs have actually all gotten changed based on what you've gotten selected, and it's cross-highlightable in any direction. So I can actually go and say, okay, I want to see only for United Kingdom, I only want to see for Germany, or I can say, okay, control click both, and I can see what is the combined cumulative effect of Germany and this thing. Right? So that's one quick way of creating reports. Reports can have multiple pages. There are more pages here, so I can just quickly show that to you. More pages which I've just created as a sample. Now these are reports. You also have a dashboard. Right? So a dashboard is basically where I've taken some parts of my report and said I want to show this as a quick dashboard so that somebody can get a quick look at what this is. And here, if you notice, there's something called ask a question about your data. This is the NLP part. I'm not going to demo that because that's, I've not set it up for that. The other thing which is very nice, and I remember that I said that for non-technical users, the ability to access this information needs to be very intuitive. So at least for now, it's on Windows 10, but you also have Power BI apps for all platforms, iOS, Android, Windows, Mac, everything. Right? So this I'm of course showing on a Windows 10 machine, and there's one intuitive thing here is that if you're using the speech assistant, you can actually go and talk to your speech assistant here on Windows 10 and ask it to show you this report. So I don't need this window open. I can actually go, I'm typing it out, but I can actually speak it out as well. So I just go and say Power BI sales report. And you will notice that the sales report comes up here. I click on it and it doesn't open a website for me. Right? It actually opens that dashboard right here with all the possibilities that I can actually do. So I don't even need to go to a website to actually go and do things like this. Right? So, and you can see the numbers are changing. So it becomes a live dashboard right there in the Windows user interface itself. Right? You can do this on Android and iOS also, as long as you install the Cortana app on that. And of course you have a pre-built app, a specific app for this as well. So that's a quick run through of Power BI, because that's not really what I'm talking about here. So now the question comes that, okay, how do I get access to this data? My data could be anywhere, right? Let's say that data is sitting on a server in my on-my premises. It could be in a data center, but for all practical purposes, that's on-premises, right? So Power BI gives something called the on-premise data gateway. This is a kind of service that gets, or an agent you could call it, which gets installed within an environment. I won't call it on the same server because it can actually handle multiple servers. It gets installed somewhere in your environment where that machine on which you install the gateway has access to all your data sources, right? Once it's installed within the network perimeter, the data gateway has access to the data sources, and that will then allow Power BI service to actually access your data. Now, the data transfer itself is completely compressed and it is encrypted, so the data on in transit is secure, right? And the data in rest is also secure on the Power BI service, so that you don't have to worry about. So you can actually go ahead and query any kind of source data very, very easily. Now, the only requirements for this gateway is that the machine has to be on an always-on server running 64-bit Windows. It could actually be even on a Windows 10 machine or even a Windows 7 or 8 machine, as long as it's a 64-bit operating system and it's always-on for all practical purposes. You can install multiple gateways within the same network. If you have that many data sources that you want to access, you can actually do it. But it should be as close as possible to the data source. So if you have a database server, let's say you have a MySQL database sitting somewhere in your data center, install the gateway on a server, either on the same server or on a server which is very close in terms of network, networking. It's as close as possible to the data source itself. By default, it uses outbound TCP 443, right, which is a secure TCP by default. But in case TCP is disabled, any kind of TCP transmission is disabled, you can configure to use HTTPS also. However, there will be a small performance penalty in the case that you do that. Now the architecture is this. This is how it works, right? So you have your Power BI service sitting somewhere here. You have something called a gateway cloud service, which is hosted again in the cloud. You don't have to worry about any of these other things. I'll come to this in a moment. You have a perimeter network here, and you install the gateway service on a machine somewhere in this network, which has access to all your other data sources. So it could be databases, it could be even files, right? It could be Excel files, it could be Access files, it could be anything. Basically, anything which could be used as a data source. It could be your analysis cubes. If you already have created analysis cubes, you can actually go ahead and do that. And as long as the gateway has access to all of them, your Power BI service will also get access. Now, one of the nice things about this gateway service is that this gateway service is actually available not just for Power BI, but for a bunch of other services as well. So there are things like Power Apps, and there's analysis services, there's logic apps. So if you're writing AI-based systems which need to access your data, which your organization's data, and take decisions and respond to users based on that data, you can actually have that work with the same data gateway. You don't have separate data gateways for each of them. It just works very, very well with all of them. Flow is, if anybody use IFTTT, right? If you use IFTTT, if this, then that, which is a very nice way of kind of getting cloud-based services to talk to each other. Flow is a enterprise version of the same thing, where you can have, if something happens, then do that kind of thing based on the data in your organization. Right, so you can actually write code, it's graphical for all practical purposes. You can actually go ahead and do that, and it works quite nicely. Now, how does the data gateway work? It allows access to your organization data in two different modes. One is direct query, where the moment I showed you a report, every time a report is generated, the report actually goes, talks to the gateway, and then goes and talks to the actual data source and pulls the data out at that point of time. Right, so it's sent every time and it's pulled, the data is pulled, so it's very, it's real time at that point of time. The moment you look at it, it's real time. Obviously, you should only use it when you want that level of real time data, because obviously there will be a little bit of lag when that happens. Your gateway server also needs to be that much more powerful to be able to access this. The other is something called scheduled refresh, where you can set up a schedule and say that, okay, I want my data to be refreshed on a hourly basis, daily basis, weekly basis, or whatever it is. And the gateway will be responsible for actually pulling that data out, populating the visualizations, and then going and showing all of that. So the configuration is very, very simple. There are two levels that you need to configure. One is on the server, the gateway server itself. And the second is configured on the Power BI cloud service. So the screenshots are not here. So what I've already done this, so I'm just going to quickly run you through a small demo of this, because I actually already did this. So what happens is, when you are installing the Power BI gateway, this is where you actually go ahead and do it. You actually go in your report, go download the gateway, run it on the server that you're trying to run it, right? It's very, very simple. Just say next, next, next. So there are two versions, but obviously the recommended version is what you should choose. There's also something called personal, which I'm not going to get into, because that's meant for, if you want it from your laptop, if you want to send some data onto Power BI, you can do that. That's using a personal gateway. But in the case of an enterprise, that's basically what you need to do. So the first time you run it, the gateway actually goes and says that it obviously says where you want to install it, and once it is installed, let this finish. And this is real time, right? I've not sped it up. This is what is happening in real time. It's actually just installing. I had done this on a server, and the data that you saw is actually coming from a server sitting somewhere. And once it's done, it then asks you for your cloud-based credentials for Power BI. So if you have a Power BI license, you basically give the cloud service credentials. And it goes and configures the gateway for you at that point of time. So on the server side, that's basically all that you need to go do. Right? So that's the email address to use with this gateway, that's it. Right? So you just basically give it, and that's my email ID that I'm actually typing in. And it'll ask me for the credential. I enter my password. Obviously, the name has to be given. What is the gateway name? Because you could have multiple gateways within your organization. So I'm just giving samples gateway or something like that, and a recovery key. Because in case you want to migrate your gateway from a lesser powerful machine to a more powerful machine, but you don't want to reconfigure all your gateways, you give it a recovery key. So you install a new server, install this, and say, okay, I want to recover from your existing gateway. Just give this password or the recovery key, and it reconfigures it based on the existing one and decommissions the old one, right? So your old server gets decommissioned, and that's it. That's done, right? That's the configuration, all that you need. And the configuration is done. You can see it's ready. The logic app requires a little bit more configuration, but for Power BI, it's kind of done. And the only configuration that you could change is this one, the HTTPS mode, right? So in case your system is not able to connect, so it stays connected. If it's not able to connect to the Power BI service, it will say not connected, right? So this one, network status connected. If it's not connected, it will show up in red and say that it's not connected. In that case, just switch this HTTPS mode on and then retry it. It should work, right? That's basically it. On the server end, on the cloud end, there's a little bit more configuration that's required. So what you do is you go to the cloud, you go to the report. So this is the report. So you go to the data set. Basically, the data set is the place, the information that you're pulling out. And you need to say that, okay, I want to pull this out using this gateway, right? So what you do is, first of all, go to the gateway. So I'll just show you. So you go to the data sets. You quickly go to the, I could actually show this to you live as well, right? So here it says you don't have a gateway installed because it is not yet, I've not yet configured it on the cloud. So I can go and say manage gateways. So there's a link which says manage gateways, and you'll see that the gateway actually shows up here. Right, so this is the gateway that I just finished installing, right, samples gateway. And now I just go and add a data source, right? So my gateway is installed. Now I need to tell the gateway, hey, where do I need to connect to? So I go and say, okay, in my case, it was a SQL Server machine. So I give it the name of the server, I give it the credentials to that server. So I'm just going to jump through this. Right, so I'm giving some credentials, and that's basically it. I can see, so now I go to the data set and say, okay, for this particular report, I want to use this gateway. Right, so now you can see that this says online. This is the gateway that is there. I will go and just turn this on, say user data gateway, apply, and it's already picked up the data source credentials automatically. Saying that, okay, fine, I understand that this data is coming from this gateway and this is the credentials that's there. That's basically it. And now I can say I want a refresh which is scheduled. So I can actually go and pick up the data on a daily basis at some particular time. I could do it multiple times a day. So the scheduled refresh is up to 1 hour, right? So I can have refreshes up to 1 hour. Panic queries are instantaneous. I mean, it's real time, right? So that's basically it. It's as simple as going ahead and setting this up and setting up your gateway to connect to a data source. So that's quick run through of Power BI. So if you have any questions, I'll take it up. And that's my comment.